Hi, I am going to talk about psychiatric disorders in adolescence. Adolescence is a phase of life between childhood and adulthood. It extends between 10 to 19 years of age. Brain development is not complete until about 20 to 25 years. Thus, some scholars consider 19 to 25 years as an extended adolescence. During adolescence, there is transition from dependence to independence. Child completes education and enters job market. Child also acquires sexual competence. Brain continues to develop during adolescence. Certain areas of the brain, such as prefrontal cortex, which is the seat of judgment and problem solving, are last to mature. Similarly, limbic system and amygdala, they develop connections with prefrontal cortex, which are involved in emotional regulation. There are major hormonal changes that take place during adolescence. Adolescent brain pours out adrenal stress hormones, sex hormones, and growth hormones, which in turn influence brain development. Sex hormones act on the limbic system and in raphe nucleus, and which is the source of neurotransmitter serotonin and is important for regulation of arousal and mood. Hormonally regulated circadian rhythm changes also change its setting during adolescent phase. There are physiological changes that occur during adolescence in the form of onset of puberty, increased sex hormones, testosterone and androgen levels, they continue to increase during this phase, which lead to increased activity, increased energy, eroticism and sex drive, also assertiveness and dominance, which is seen in adolescent phase. Adolescent phase is also characterized by a physical growth spurt. Growth spurt occurs relatively at earlier age in girls, for example, between 9 to 13 years, and in boys, growth spurt occurs at 11 to 16 years of age. There are cognitive changes during this phase. There is spurt in intellectual development. There is increased verbal, mathematical, and visual spatial abilities. Thinking changes to become more analytical, creative, abstract, and purposive. There are emotional changes in the form that emotions become increased in depth and intensity. Development of identity and self-concept is another major developmental task for adolescents. Significant changes also take place in the area of social and moral development. During adolescence, they start seeking independence. There is quest for independence. Their friendships become more intense and more durable. Their peer relationships become initially attraction towards same sex and later on moves towards heterosexual attraction. Relationship with parents is redefined. There is increased exploration, risk-taking and adventure. Also, adolescence phase is characterized by intense idealism, rejection of social norms and radical thinking. Friendships become more durable and intense. Emotions increase in depth and intensity. Sexuality, there is general increase in sexual urges. And there is development of attachment to someone of same sex initially. And there can be transient homosexuality and masturbation. Identity and self-concept emerges. Child develops self-esteem, commitment to a particular occupation, religion, or a political ideology. Also, there is emergence of sex roles and concern with physical attractiveness. In adolescence, relationship with parents is redefined. There can be estrangement between child and the parents. There are arguments and conflicts between them. Adolescents, they want parents to be less restrictive and liberal, and this is often construed as generation gap. They also engage in exploration and risk-taking. May have a tendency to reject social norms and standards, and they start questioning the prevailing value systems. There are multiple influences on development. There are innate biological and genetic factors at the inner core, and then there are layers of experiential influences starting from early parenting to school to peer factors and societal influences. All these influences change over time and interact with one another in a complex reciprocal manner. Psychiatric disorders in adolescence can be grouped into three broad types. There are disorders that start in childhood and continue to into adolescence. For example, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, pervasive developmental disorder, learning disabilities, and conduct disorders. Then there are a group of disorders of adulthood that start in adolescence. For example, schizophrenia, depression, neurotic disorders, personality disorders, they all have their beginning in adolescence. And there are disorders which are unique to adolescence. These are relatively less well-defined disorders, and they depict symptoms related to mood, behavior, conduct, and relationships. Talking about the prevalence of psychiatric disorders, figures vary between 10 to 20% in different studies in different countries. According to a British mental health survey reported in 2004, 1 in 10 children and young people aged 5 to 16 had a clinically diagnosed mental disorders. 4% out of these had emotional disorders, 6% had conduct disorder, 2% as hyperkinetic disorder, and 1% had less common disorders such as autism, tics, and eating disorders, etc. Lifetime prevalence of mental disorders in US adolescents, reports from a national comorbidity study have found the rates to be for anxiety disorders, it was 31.9%, behavior disorders it was 19%, mood disorder about 14%, and substance use disorder about 11%. Anxiety and related disorders were the most common disorders found in national comorbidity survey. Adolescents with one class of disorder who also meet criteria for another class of lifetime disorder were in the range of 40%. Then there are groups of less well-defined disorders. These are often mentioned as adolescent issues or problems. These are most commonly seen problems and are often phase-specific. They tend to settle down with development. And as I already said, they are seen in four main domains of mood, behavior, school problems, and relationship problems. In the area of mood difficulties, adolescents may present with a dysphoric mood, which is in the form of a non-specific sadness, feelings of emptiness and boredom, loneliness, atypical depression, sleep problems, suicidal ideas, and sometimes accident proneness. Then the behavioral problems manifest in the form of absconding or violence, antisocial or delinquent activities, theft or vandalism, indulgence in alcohol or drug abuse, and sexual problems, promiscuity, and so on. In the area of educational and school difficulties, there can be disenchantment with conventional education. They may have poor school performance, truancy, poor concentration, and lack of interest in studies. Then relationship problems often seen in this phase are peer relationship difficulties. They may have peer pressure, problems of sexual intimacy, and relationships. Certain changes take place in patterns of psychiatric disorders in adolescence. Neurodevelopmental disorders such as ADHD, learning disabilities, pervasive developmental disorders, they change their presentation or may change frequency or severity during this phase, but they continue through adolescence into adulthood. There is male preponderance for these disorders. Emotional disorders become more differentiated in adolescence, and sex ratio changes to female preponderance. Conduct disorders rise in frequency to its peak at mid-teens. Disorders that make their first appearance or show marked rise in frequency in adolescence are depression, anorexia nervosa, schizophrenia, substance use disorders, anxiety disorders, phobia, and OCD. Now we come to causes. Causes of psychiatric disorders in adolescents are multiple, and they relate to several factors. There can be factors in the child, there can be factors in the parents or family, or factors in the environment or society. In the child, there are issues about temperamental adversity. As we know, children have an inborn innate temperament, and this temperament is relatively stable, and certain adverse presentations of these temperaments can make them more vulnerable to develop psychiatric disorders. Then, level of intelligence. Low intelligence is a risk factor for psychiatric disorders. Then genetic factors and presence of brain disorders such as epilepsy or any other brain disorder also predisposes them to develop psychiatric disorder more often. Then factors in the parents and family, they pertain to the parental relationships, parental discord or family pathology, faulty communication, their parenting and handling patterns, inconsistent parenting, poor role modeling, presence of alcoholism, substance use or mental disorder in the family, when parents or family members are non-supportive, unhelpful, uninvolved or have poor supervision of the children, absence or lack of time on their part. Then other issues are critical, hostile, disapproving or punitive parenting and unduly high expectations. All these pose a risk factor for development of psychiatric disorder. Looking at environmental factors, life stress and environmental stress is a major contributor. Then, in educational realm, their heavy curriculum, poor teaching facilities, uninterested, unmotivated teachers, high competition are some of the risk factors seen in many countries. Social and peer influences are extremely important at this age. Culture and lifestyle issues, confusion of value systems, and peer influences do contribute to development of psychiatric disorders and difficulties in adolescent phase. Mass media these days has a very major effect on the developing brain and the mind. Children are exposed to undesirable elements in media. The programs often show distortion of reality and impedes their thinking process and judgment. It makes children more inactive, dull, at times violent and insensitive. Exposure to information that they are cognitively not mature to handle causes confusion in their own mind, and many times they end up taking wrong decisions. Now we come to treatment of psychiatric disorders. Intervention is multimodal. It involves the child, the family, the school, and the environment. These are also linked to causative factors which are identified in a given case. There are certain general principles which are used to advise and guide parents on how to handle and deal with adolescents. Prevention is better than the intervention when the problem has already occurred, so we must always focus on preventive intervention. In terms of parental advice and guidance, the general principles involve advice to know and understand their child, to use patience. Parents have to exhibit a lot of patience in dealing with adolescents. They are advised to change their handling patterns from being authoritative to becoming more friendly. They should respect and regard their opinion, involve them in decision making, have open communication, discuss issues with them, spend time with them, clearly convey opinion and giving reasons and in a logical manner, give reward and praise for their achievements, set clear rules which are based on principles. Effort should be made to know their mind, and there should be attempt to establish a confiding relationship between parents and adolescent. Therapeutic approaches involve the use of multidisciplinary teamwork, which comprises of psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, teachers, and parents. And there should be a realistic appraisal of objectives, and a full range of psychiatric treatments can be used. There are specific indications for the use of drugs or medication. These are given for symptomatic relief. For example, if the child has anxiety, insomnia, depression, or psychosis, then medication can be given to relieve these symptoms. Or medication can be given for prevention of destructive or self-destructive behavior, or for specific treatment of psychiatric disorders, for example, schizophrenia or MDP. Then there is a list of other various psychological therapies that can be used. Depending on the requirements and objectives, usually multiple therapeutic strategies are required in a given case. And these treatment strategies are individual psychotherapy, behavior therapy, cognitive therapy and cognitive restructuring, group therapy, parental and family therapy, school liaison, Residential or inpatient treatment is needed sometimes for severe problems such as psychotic condition, severe conduct disorder, or when there are severe family problems or for offenders. And then legal and community services are also required. Most of the disorders in adolescence, they run true to type. Prognosis varies according to the diagnosis, and it is not different from that for similar disorders in adulthood. Out of the less well-defined disorders seen in adolescence, they have better outlook. 80% of those who present with emotional and neurotic or stress-related symptoms, their problems improve. 50% of conduct problems improve, and about 45% of psychotic symptoms also do improve. There are certain bad prognostic features, and these are early academic failure, poor peer relationships, gradual onset, low energy level, abnormalities of personality, and family pathology. There are certain factors that promote healthy development and support good prognosis. So good prognostic factors are high intelligence, easy and adaptive temperament, absence of family pathology, positive, supportive, and understanding environment, strong family system and family ties, secure, consistent, and positive caring relationship with at least one adult, and reasonably high expectations. Outcome varies according to the underlying biological vulnerability and external risk and protective factors. Most adolescents, they get over their problems by 20 to 22 years of age. Generation gap is inevitable and essential for development. 10 to 15% of them, they continue with problems that require long-term psychiatric help. Most adult psychiatric disorders that begin in adolescence, they have poor prognosis. Most child psychiatric disorders that continue through adolescence, they need continued support and care in several domains such as education and life skills. In conclusion, mental health of adolescents is deeply rooted in their biopsychosocial and cultural development. In many cultures, adolescents are treated like adults. There is no special focus on adolescence as a phase of life. In India and in many other low-income countries, adolescents may work to supplement family income, they may get married and still continue to live with their parents. They are expected to follow the authority of parents and elders in the family and may have little psychological independence. Specialized mental health facilities for adolescents are often not available. It does not mean that there is high morbidity in these countries or in these cultures. It only means that sociocultural expectations guide the definition of normalcy and pathology. And any effort to understand and treat mental health problems in adolescence must address these complex sociocultural issues. Thank you.